Hello, everybody. My name is Manuela, and it's my pleasure today to welcome you to our first webinar. While drinking your morning coffee, you can listen to Martin getting a first insight about jobs to be done and outcome-driven innovation. We will start in a couple of minutes, so please take this chance to grab your coffee or tea if you don't have one already. I would like to introduce ourselves as one of the team members behind Edison, and Martin to you all. Edison, formerly known as Strategy in IoT, is your partner for growth by customer-centric innovation. We help you to identify the real customer needs and develop growth strategies. We launched our new brand 2 weeks ago, and this webinar is our first event as Edison. Martin is managing partner at Edison and holds an MBA from the Vienna University of Business Administration and Economics, and has more than 2 decades experience in innovation. He has been the project manager of many innovation projects in the fields of mechanical engineering, construction industry, energy management, information technology, and also medical devices. Finally, something organizational. After the webinar, I will send you the slides and also a link so you can listen to the webinar again. And of course, if you have any questions, don't be shy. So let's get started. Martin, the mic is yours.
So, hello, good morning, everybody. I'm very happy to be here today with you in the webinar. And I would like to guide you through our story today while you have your morning coffee. What we want to do is introduce outcome-driven innovation and job to be done theory and how we deal with it and work with it in practice. The agenda shows you that we will start off with the theory, what is job to be done at all. Many of you already have heard about it and probably also practice it. And we will then jump into the approach outcome-driven innovation, which is a process to operationalize job to be done theory in an organization and to bring growth strategies to the streets. Our company, Edison, is not a new company. So we are on the market. We have been on the market since 15 years already, working in a very strong exclusive cooperation with Strategy in USA. As you heard from Manuela, we are now rebranded. Our former name was Strategy in IIP, Innovation in Progress. So we wanted to make this more crisp by adding Edison. It comes from Edison, Thomas Alva Edison, who innovated a new way to innovate by doing it customer-centric. And the ZON in the name stands for the New Horizons. You can find by looking at your market from a different perspective, and that is the job to be done perspective. So what do we want to achieve? Where do we want to support you? We want to create growth strategies, and we want to answer 5 specific questions related to that. First of all, what opportunities exist for value creation in your market? The second question would be, how should you position your existing products? This is about communications. The third point, how should you improve your existing products? Like, what about the existing product lineup? What about existing services? How can you improve that by addressing certain unmet needs? And then we also answer the question on what new offerings are needed to really fill gaps in the existing product or service portfolio, things that are not there so far, and that would be kind of really innovative. And finally, when we look at the 5th question related to growth strategies, it is about the question of what long-term strategy should be pursued to get the entire job done. And what that means, we will go into later on in the presentation. It all is based, what we do is all based on theory, advanced theory in practice. You probably have read already What Customers Want, a book from Tony Alvick, and the latest book from Tony, Jobs to be Done and Outcome-Driven Innovation in Practice. There is a lot of stuff that you will find on the internet. Just click on jobstobedone.com or visit our website, edisoninnovation.com. There is a lot of references here. What I want to highlight is that we basically work in any kind of industry, from B2B to B2C industries, from technology companies, IT companies, up to healthcare organizations, healthcare companies, where we do a lot of business, and also services like financial services. So it can be applied probably or effectively in any kind of industry when we look at the job to be done. So what is the power of job to be done theory? I want to start with a flop that was happening in the early 90s. And you probably, some of you might remember that story, the PC Junior that was brought to market by IBM. And it totally flopped on the first day on the market. So that was a big problem that time for IBM and a big loss as well. Tony Alvig was in that product development team, and he then went out with the mission to fix innovation and to make innovation a process that will deliver business results for sure and reliably. So the question that he brought forward was, what metrics will customers use to evaluate the attractiveness of a new product or a service offering? And if you would understand that kind of metrics, it would guide us for product and service development. So what is innovation? In our understanding, innovation is process, and it's a process of devising solutions that address unmet customer needs, which sounds very familiar and very logic. Now, when you look at the process in detail, you have two possibilities. You can start at ideas first, like to find out what could be done, what ideas would be there, and then watch out if there would be a need for that idea. You probably know that many cases, there's just not a need there. And it's also not easy to understand which ideas need to be created related to certain needs. So this process is not delivering reliable results, and therefore it's quite logic to start needs first. When we want to start needs first, we face some challenges. What is a need? That's the core question to start with. And we realize that there isn't agreement on how to define a need or on what types of needs exist. I want to highlight this with some keywords like you find out there, customer needs, expectations, latent needs, exciters, pains, delighters, features, wants, must-haves. You know that from discussions also with colleagues, probably over a coffee, when you exchange each other on what needs are out there. Now, what is a need? We want to define a need as a constant. So that is, so to say, what is pretty logic if we understand that a need would be a constant and solutions would be variables, like you need to come up with better solutions on to get needs done better, existing needs done better, you would have kind of a guideline for your innovation process. And if you want to achieve it, to define needs independent of solutions and independent of time and of changes over time, we need to add a different perspective to what a need is. And that is starting with this citation from Theodore Levitt, people don't want a quarter-inch drill, they want a quarter-inch hole. So it's not about the drill, it's not about the solution to look at, and the solution should not be the unit of analysis. Nobody needs to have a drill, but what people really need to have is probably a hole in the wall. Now that we talk about the need, free of any solutions, we might realize it's not a hole in the wall. No, it's a picture to hang. So people want to hang a picture. And then again, we can ask, okay, why do they hang a picture? We find out, okay, they want to decorate the office. And if they want to decorate the office, probably that is still a solution for something higher, for a higher order job probably. And that would be to increase productivity or make people more happy while working. Now you realize when you talk about a job to be done, it really depends on how you frame a job to be done. And to put it in a nutshell, a job to be done should always be framed according to the objectives of a corporation. Like if you would be the drill producer, you want to frame the job to be done on a higher level than probably making a hole in the wall. But you do not want to go up to like decorating office spaces because that would be out of sight, out of your scope. So in that case, probably a job to be done for a drill producer would be to support workers in doing an installation work on a construction site or something like this. That would be kind of a solution scope that could somehow be addressable for a drill producer if they would go for additional services, if they would go for additional products and come up with a solution offering that gets the whole job done for the executor. Having said that, there are three major points when we talk about job to be done as a perspective. First of all, people buy products and services only to help them get a job done. And therefore, the job and not the product or the customer is the unit of analysis. And the job is stable over time, making it a constant in the equation. I will have some examples on that later on to give you kind of some color to that statement that the job is stable over time. So now, outcome-driven innovation, that is the process that breaks down job-to-be-done thinking into real growth strategies and into operations. And the process consists of basically five major steps. The first two steps are qualitative research steps. So here we want to frame a market according to the job to be done, and we also want to uncover the needs that are tied to the job to be done. In steps 3 and 4, it's about quantitative research. Here we want to prioritize needs, and by generating data in the field, we can then discover hidden segments of opportunity, as we call that. So different needs profiles and different segments of needs in the market. In the final step, step 5, everything is being put together to use that data model to formulate a winning growth strategy. To be more specific, we talk about formulating market strategies, like how to position products and services, how to communicate products and services, and also product strategies. So, what products to create. Let me jump into this a little bit more detail. So, defining the market. In our understanding, a market is always defined by the job and the job executor. How can we define a market coming from kind of a product-based market view that is very common? When you look at the music market, you see different product categories out there, like LP, CD, MP3, streaming market. And these are products coming up on and on. So if you would be in the music industry as a product manager or as a UX designer, you would probably look at the products and try to make them better. Having said that, it's always a race looking in kind of the rear view mirror, because if you would improve the CDs on and on and on, you would still be in the CD market and probably missing the MP3 market or even the streaming market. So having said that, we need to add a different perspective, and the job to be done perspective in that case would be that it is just one market and it's just one job to be done that is being addressed with these various solutions, and the job is listen to music. So that's a market that's already there for 100 years, and it will probably be there for way more years than we have seen it. So listen to music is kind of a stable market definition, and that is stable over time. Now, a market is defined as a group of people and the job they're trying to get done. So once we have defined the job to be done, we then also want to know what the group of people is that we want to create value for. And we can define that. We can define that we want to create value for all music enthusiasts out there. Or we can define that we want to create value only for people who are doing sports while doing music, or for people who are listen to music while on the go. So there are different possibilities to split down a market definition into different groups of people that one wants to create value for. A good starting point is to start with the broad definition, like all people who want to listen to music, that should be addressed with, and that should be analyzed, kind of, okay, what makes it difficult to listen to music? Another example for a job-based market definition would be parents who want to pass on life lessons to children. That is a market. Everybody who has children or knows some children and in their families or parents with children, they will understand that, yes, that's a job to be done, and that can also be analyzed, and it's not supported perfectly with existing solutions. And the beauty of it is that is a solution-free definition of a market, and that market probably will be here also in 50 years, 100 years to come. Another example here is from the construction industry, like you have tradesmen and they want to cut piece of wood in a straight line. You see that is a market definition, a job definition that is on a kind of lower level of abstraction. And it's more close to the product that is in scope here from that company, Bosch, who is doing circular saws. So again, even if you stay close to your existing products, a job definition always must be free of any solutions. And then we talk about electric vehicles and digitalization. In the automotive industry and in machinery engineering, for example, you could frame a market like automotive engineers that want to distribute engine power. And distributing engine power will probably be a job to be done as long as you have cars and vehicles, no matter if that is a combustion engine in front of it or if it's an electric engine in front of it. So you can see defining markets free of solutions and free of technologies give you a stable understanding of the business that you are in and the purpose that you are in, and starts a line of research that will generate long-term valid results. And a medical device example, would be interventional cardiologists who want to restore blood flow in a blocked artery. So even if you're not an expert in that area, you will probably initially understand what is meant with that job statement. Everybody will get a good understanding of it, and we do not use technical terms that probably nobody understands. Okay, so summary of that job to be done: don't ask what your product does. Ask the customer, ask the group of people that you want to create value for, ask them what they are trying to get done. Not what the product does, but what they are trying to get done. So that's the major takeaway that I want to share with you related to how to come up with a job definition. Now, once we have framed a job to be done that we want to create value for, we want to understand exactly is missing in that job to be done. We want to exactly understand what's in it, what exactly is the needs or are the needs related to that job to be done. And here comes, so to say, the job map framework that I also want to share with you. Once you have defined a job to be done, a job to be done is always to be understood as a process. And once you have understood it as a process, you can put it into its components and see what job steps are involved in getting the job done and also what desired outcomes are involved. So what are the desired outcomes that people have when they get each step of the job done? So you see it gets really detailed on that part, and I would like to share just the first few points of job mapping. Now you see here we have 8 steps, and these 8 steps are the typical standard universal steps of every job to be done. So if you want to describe a job as a process can be described in an ideal format. That means every process has an ideal format. We know that from process management, and there are tools out there like Six Sigma. That help you describe a process in its ideal format, in its ideal way. So we can describe a job to be done based on that framework already in its ideal way, like what people are trying to get done, no matter if this is being executed already today with existing approaches or existing processes that people use. So we have here an ideal model of how a job should be looking like and how what people want to achieve in it. Now, these 8 steps, for an example, I can break down also to listen to music. And when you want to listen to music, you want to define something, which means you want to assess the situation. You want to locate things related to that job, and that would be, for example, gather the desired music. You want to prepare for the execution, which would include to order the music for listening. You want to confirm before you execute, and in that case, that could be to confirm the music plan. And you execute, and here actually you listen to music, and then it comes monitoring, modifying, and concluding the experience and the job to be done. So structuring a job to be done like this helps you also to come up with the right questions when you want to better understand what's happening in that job from the viewpoint of the customers. And second of all, you also make sure that you capture everything that is involved. So if a job is fully described with these 8 steps, and you have the information around these 8 steps, you basically effectively generate a needs model that includes all the needs related to a specific job to be done. And that is what we want to achieve. So we want to, in this part of the process, we want to understand all the needs related to a certain job to be done. Once we have done that, we can work already strategically with it and create a business vision, because every job and every solution has to try to get the job done better, first of all, and second of all, get more of the job done to be attractive for a customer. So when you look at MP3 players, they already get a little bit more of the job done than just the execution of listening. You get some more of the job steps done with an MP3 player. Now you can really map out solutions against the job. When you look at streaming services, they already get even more of the job done than an MP3 player. Do they get everything done of the job to be done, the streaming services that we see on the market now? Probably not. Do we exactly know what is still missing in existing streaming services? We can find this out quite easily and quite fast, and I will show you how. A need is a metric that a customer uses to measure success when getting a job done. Now, this leads me to outcomes. You have seen that job model with the different steps inside, and now we want to deep dive and understand the desired outcomes, for example, when listening to music. And the desired outcome would be, when assessing the situation in the first step of that process, minimize the time it takes to determine how much music will be needed, e.g. minutes, etc. Another desired outcome, just for an example, would be to minimize the time it takes to determine what songs to include. And I have one more example, like minimize the time it takes to determine the order in which to play the songs. Now, while executing, it would be a desired outcome for people to minimize the likelihood that the music sounds distorted when played at high volume. So what you see here in all of these statements, they are following a specific syntax. So they are all formulated in the same style, and this is what makes sure that we generate a common needs language that everybody can understand and that is free of any solutions. So these need statements here do not contain any solution, any product feature, any software, any technology. They are free of any solutions, and therefore they are valid over time. So we can be sure that people also in 10 years from now want to minimize the likelihood that the music sounds distorted when played at high volume. We can also be sure that there will probably be better solutions out there. And we can be sure that it is possible to create better solutions. So what we want to create here is a needs model that guides our innovation and research activities for the next, I would say, 5 to 10 years to come. Another example here would be minimize the time it takes to remove songs that you no longer want to hear. Now, there is a certain syntax related to outcome statements, and you see that here on the slide. like minimize the time it takes to get the songs in the desired order for listening. We will share this syntax and also the background of all that language also in our other formats and in our summit and in our masterclass sessions. So I do not want to go too much into detail now on this. So what is better? What means getting a job done better? We want to get the job done faster, first of all, and we want to get it done more predictably and with higher output or throughput. So that means get the job done faster, try to come up with solutions that make the job be executable faster, more predictably, with less variance, with less errors, and with higher output or throughput. So this is how you make people happy who want to listen to music, by coming up with solutions that get these three parameters done better throughout the whole process. And as I said, you can map out solutions now against needs. This is being shown in this metrics here, a predictive model for growth. Now looking at all the desired outcomes and mapping it out, how good these outcomes are being supported and addressed by different solutions that are out there, or solution concepts that you might have in mind already, will really help you to identify gaps in the market and areas where you probably need to come up with better solutions, or where there is no solution at all at the moment, where you should probably come up with some radical new stuff. We know that it's not just for functional jobs that people want to get done, but we always start with that. So what I want to show you here is the Jobs to Be Done Needs Framework, and it highlights all the needs related to a business. So when we start off with the core functional job, as we did now in these examples, we can come up with desired outcomes, and that will inform us how to get the job done better and or more cheaply, and how to create better solutions that actively, functionally get the job done better. On the other hand, we also want to know related jobs that people want to get done. So what other things are people people want to get done when probably they want to listen to music? Like a related job could be learning to dance. Another related job could be play music on my own. Another job could be to share music with my friends. So you see there are some related jobs, quite a bunch of related jobs in quite any business, that you can find out by asking for related functional jobs, what other things people want to get done when they listen to music or while listening to music. And it's all about emotions as well, of course. We see emotional jobs also relevant. And emotional jobs are kind of personal emotional jobs or social emotional jobs. So how do people want to feel while getting a job done? And how do people want to be perceived by others while getting a job done? This emotional information will help you to better position products and to better communicate benefits of products. Typically, emotional needs do not really inform product or service development, as they are by definition emotional and not functional. And so you need to capture those emotional elements and emotional jobs and use it in your marketing, mainly in your marketing activities. Consumption chain jobs are related to solutions. So this is how to get a solution, how to find the right solution to get my job done, how to install that solution, how to learn how to use it, how to maintain it, and how to, you know, upgrade it probably and replace a specific solution. So these consumption chain jobs are often related to what can be called a customer journey. It's also important to look at these consumption chain jobs because they very often also offer possibilities for differentiation on the market. And the fifth pillar in that needs framework is the buyer's job with the financial outcomes. So we also must know what the buyer's job look like. We must know what financial outcomes are there, how relevant they are, how important they are, and how well satisfied with existing solutions they are. And putting now all these five pillars together, we have the basis to create comprehensive business models, including hardware products, software products, services, communication measures, all the channel activities related to the consumption chain jobs, and also the financial aspects of a business model. So this really informs long-term business model development when you walk into that needs framework. So the key ODI insight here is that I also want to share with you, the art is not in the questioning, it is in the listening. We want to understand what people are trying to achieve and come up with insights on this. Therefore, it's also not necessary to generate all these insights just with talking to people. You can probably also blend this and mix these research approaches with reading stuff, with reading books, with having secondary data that you skim through, that you look at existing customer questionnaires, books, and so on. So a lot of things that can be done here. Now, let us jump over to the quantitative part of the framework. We want to not only understand all the needs that are out there in the market, we also want to know the priorities of them. And to achieve that, we create questionnaires that show us which outcome is unmet and how important it is for a customer population. Now look at the ODI-based research questionnaire. This is a schematic example here, where you have a list of outcomes. Typically, we have approximately 100 outcome statements related to a job to be done. And we then want to understand how important each of these statements is for the executor and how satisfied they are with existing solutions. When we put that together in a questionnaire and then get back the results, yeah, we can easily create an opportunity landscape that looks like this here. We have a need here, like this outcome statement that you can see on this dot, like minimize the time it takes to get the songs in the desired order for listening. And that statement was rated on an importance axis and also on a satisfaction axis. I do not want to go into the details of that opportunity scoring model here, as you will find this also in publications, and of course we are happy to share this with you in case of any questions. This should just highlight what we basically do here. And when you look at all the needs that you analyze in such a questionnaire, you get a lot of dots, you know, a lot of outcomes on your opportunity landscape. And depending on where these dots are located on the landscape, you will find needs, you will find desired outcomes that are extremely underserved, like very important and not very well satisfied. That's on the right-hand side of the opportunity landscape. That calls for innovation. And on the other hand, you will also find overserved needs, overserved outcomes that are not important for the customer's population, but very well satisfied with existing solutions. And these overserved needs also call for specific innovation strategies, and let me mention here, disruptive approaches, like to come up with solutions that get the job done worse, but way cheaper than existing solutions. Then we also find table stakes. This is when a need is extremely important and already very well served, which you find in some industries, also in very critical industries like electronics or medical devices. These table stakes you should be aware of, and be aware of that you do not touch them in a way to probably conflict satisfaction scores. Leave them on the table, so to say. Once we have this data for total markets, we can now use the data and create a real data model that show us also hidden segments of opportunity. Segmentation is a process of discovering groups of customers, of job executors, that have different unmet outcomes, different unmet needs. And as we all know in product management and UX design, in business development, not all job executors are alike. And I want to give you an example. Now, if you look at a real study that we did, it delivered back values like this. Like, we had all of these outcome statements quite in an area with average importance and average satisfaction scores So this is a market, when you look at it like this, where you cannot really innovate a lot of things. You can make products and solutions a little bit cheaper and a little bit better, but take care, you will immediately run into an overserved area if you do too much on this. So this is not really a market, a total market perspective, where you can do a lot of things. In that case, coming back to the job map, to the job needs framework, you would want to probably look at related jobs that still are not being served well at the moment. Like when you're in the music industry, look at jobs like learn how to dance or learn how to sing or learn how to play music on my own. So that would then be related jobs with probably new business potential. Now, when we want to segment the market and we take classic criteria like gender, we typically see in all of our projects that gender usually does not really reveal meaningful differences in needs profiles. And also age does not really reveal meaningful differences in satisfaction levels on getting a job done. The same is true for regions. And we see these patterns no matter if you look at B2C markets or B2B markets, it's kind of always the same. And a typical result if you use classical market segmentation methodologies. Therefore, we identify complexity factors, and these complexity factors explain how complex it is to get a job done. And usually, market segments derive out of context issues that make it difficult or less difficult to get a job done. And by doing that, with statistical analysis, we then realize, so to say, the true market segmentation, the true needs segmentation in the market. And in that example here, you can see that in that market, we see four different need segments, four different colors. And we also see how large these segments are in the total market. And to look at the extremes, now on the left-hand side, the red dots, these are 15% of the respondents. That say the job to be done with all of its outcomes is not so relevant at all and it's super satisfied. So that segment probably would call for a disruptive strategy and for different types of services and different types of products. And when you look at the very right-hand side, the purple segment with 33% of all participants that are highly underserved with many outcomes in getting the job done. That again would then call for probably a differentiated strategy where you come up with additional services, new services, and also charge more for them because these executors are typically also prepared to pay for and have higher willingness to pay for better solutions, which by the way, we also generate in our insights, the willingness to pay questions. Now, knowing the target is the key to success. So what do we do with these dots now? We actually have that in our model, in our results database, and we can see a list of outcome statements, a list of needs, and an opportunity score. The opportunity score so is the consists of importance and satisfaction. It can be between 0 and 20. Everything above 10 is a high opportunity for innovation. Every opportunity score above 10 means that this dot, this outcome, lies in this triangle, in this dark gray triangle on the right-hand side of the opportunity landscape. So here we can really have a very informed look at what the most important needs are. And the example that you see here is cutting wood in a straight line. That was the circular saw example that I can share here with you. And you can see that there are some outcome statements with very high opportunity scores. As a product team, you can work with that. As a marketing team, you can work with that, communicate probably existing stuff that you can already add here and values that you can already offer with an existing product. And that's how strategy is then being derived. So market and product strategy. By the way, this was a big success for Bosch in the US market for circular saws. They entered that market where they haven't been present for up until then, and it was a hit from the first moment. Now, finally, what to do with it, and what to do with all these insights and with all that stuff? We can create a growth strategy out of that data model. The data model is used to address sales, inform sales about what arguments to use, how to approach different segments of customers. It informs marketing, how to come up with the right type of messaging for the right type of customer segments. It informs planning, product planning, like lineup planning and long-term product portfolio planning. It informs development, R&D, and also other company challenges like even M&A activities that are being guided and informed with this type of insights. Now, let me share the Job to be Done growth strategy metrics with you. That is, so to say, that puts together the whole story now. We identify two axes of improvement for a market or product strategy. You can position yourself in the in on one axis to get a job done better or to get a job done worse. This is also an option, to get a job done worse. And on the other axis, you can charge more or charge less for getting the job done. Now, putting these two possibilities together, these two axes together, we see that a differentiated strategy would mean you get a job done better and also charge more for it, a classically differentiated strategy. Like we see this in an example would be Uber, where you have the Uber Black service, you get a limousine service, it's being charged, they charge a little bit more for it, and you get the job done better, you get a limousine driver only for yourself. On the other hand, you can get a job done worse and charge less, which would be a disruptive strategy. And that disruptive strategy could also be kind of derived out of the Uber example. You know, the Uber service where you can put together many people in just one taxi. You need to wait until they come. You need to make sure that everything is coordinated. And then you take a taxi ride, not on your own, but with other people as well. And you jump in and you get out and you pay way less than if you would book a normal Uber or a normal taxi. Now, the dominant strategy is like putting everything together, get the job done better, and also charge less. And that's the classic Uber service where you get the job done better and being charged less than with a normal taxi. Now, this example should also show that probably you need to have different strategies for a market depending on the needs profiles in that market. So depending on the customer segments that you have identified, like I showed before, you know, when you have this segment of totally overserved customers and another segment of totally underserved customers, you probably need to come up with different product and service strategies. And this can be derived in these strategy metrics. Give you some examples here, like a market that looks like this on an opportunity landscape with a lot of outcomes, with a lot of needs in the right-hand side of the landscape, very underserved market, you probably come up with a product strategy where you differentiate versions, version 1, version 2, and version 3. With version 1, with product or service version 1, you would directly attack and address these extremely underserved needs on the very right-hand side. Then in your product lineup, in your product road mapping, you would come up with a version 2 product and feature set to address other needs that are underserved, and so it goes ahead with version 3 and so on. And always charge more for getting the job done. That could also run into a dominant strategy. Like at one point you would consider, okay, can we get the job done better with our different product and service versions and same time charge less for it? And guess what? Digital platforms do exactly that. So they get the job done better, and usually it's cheaper for consumers and less expensive if you have a platform business model in place, which would then be called a dominant strategy. But this is to be discussed and decided on a very informed quantitative basis in product management and also in UX design and in corporate new business development. which strategy to follow, always based on this data. A dominant strategy could also be applied if you see a market like this here on the landscape, where you have certain needs that are underserved, where you want to come up with a solution that gets that needs done better. And on the other hand, you have a number of needs that are totally overserved, where you want to get the job done cheaper and probably follow a disruptive strategy here. Now, when you put everything together, that could be a dominant strategy. Now, an example would be online banking. You know, when you compare financial services, managing personal finance, that would be a job to be done. Then there were many needs were not really addressed according to customers' expectations. Before you had online banking, you know, like you needed to go there at the bank on your own every day, you needed to have something. And on the other hand, many needs were probably also overserved. Probably many people don't need to have a personal assistant helping them in doing their money transactions every day. A dominant strategy would be, an example would be online banking in the financial services industry. And you probably find many, many other examples as well. If you look at a market that purely looks like this, when you find out that you have a certain total market that looks like this, or a market segment which would call for a disruptive strategy, interesting enough is, and this is to be considered when looking at the market from that perspective, from the job perspective, is that you also will address customers that at the moment don't even use your solutions at all. Like imagine people who want to cut wood in a straight line. There are many people that just don't use a circular saw for that because their job to be done is not so relevant, and it's perfectly served with existing solutions like cutting it manually with a saw on your own. So the circular saw producer will understand that he is in a market where he competes with totally different types of solutions that get the job done good enough, and that would call for a disruptive strategy to come up with whatever kind of really cheap solution that get the job done good enough, and by doing so, attracting customers to your business that not have been in your business at all so far. So disruptive strategies can really generate a lot of new business for companies. Now, the sustaining strategy would be if you have a market looking like this opportunity landscape here, where you have a lot of table stakes, a few opportunities left over where you can get a job done better. That would be these typical markets where you have very ripe products in the market, and you know, find out the one or the other element in the job to be done that can be still supported better with a new solution. Again, when running into a sustaining strategy, please always consider to also look at related jobs that could offer totally new business development potential, and that would call for more than just one strategy as well. Now, yeah, we also have some references that I want to share with you. I just picked out a number of them. Kind of, okay, what for? So what does it bring? What does it deliver? What's the deliverable at the end of the day? At the end of the day, these viewpoints and these approaches really help companies develop their business beyond their existing borders. One example is the Cordis Corporation, which is now a Johnson & Johnson company, did that market analysis of restoring blood flow in a blocked artery. And what came out of it was a whole roadmap of anchor plastic balloons and also the stent that was successfully brought to the market and generated a $1 billion business in just 2 years, which was also highlighted by Harvard Business Review. Another reference here would be from the automotive industry, where General Motors identified business potential around the market of arrive on time in a city. So arriving on time in a city really has a lot of innovation potential, and that was sized by GM with $1 billion US dollars per year. By that time, strategy in USA also formed a joint venture to pursue that that opportunities. We have been working for a lot of IT companies. One is Microsoft, where we did more than 40 projects over the years. And a reference here was the software service business that was generating an 8-time growth to 1.2 billion, also within just 1 year. And generated with Dave Washer from Microsoft. A medical device example, Roche Diabetes Care and Roche Diagnostics are partners of us, and we have been working for these companies for a number of years already, and found new ways to also guide corporate strategy and business product and business development down to marketing communications. We will present these references, and we will present real case studies by the end of March in Vienna at the first Job to be Done Summit in Vienna, where you will meet a lineup of these partners of us, of our clients, where they also will share their success stories. So another one from financial services was GE Money, where we worked on innovation related to new channels for the company. And in the Unilever, we were looking at the healthcare business, again, from a job to be done perspective. Now, when you put everything together, this ODI data model informs a lot of functions in an organization, starting from marketing to product lifecycle support to product portfolio management, product planning, product development and design, up until digital, IoT, M&A, R&D, and business model innovation. And I'm very, very happy to share also insights and further examples with you if that would be of interest for you. Now, we have come to a point in time where it would be time for wrap up and Q&A, I would like to give you the opportunity now to come up with questions if they would be here, and please come up and share it with all of us, and I would have the possibility probably to go into that. Okay, now I see something coming up here. So while your comments are being posted, I would like to go ahead and really invite you to our first Job to be Done Summit in Europe. That will take place on 27 and 28 of March in Vienna. You see here the castle of Schönbrunn, where we'll have the first evening, the 27, an inspirational dinner together with Tony Alvig. And we will jump into the job to be done language and job to be done talks together with executors of job to be done, corporate users of job to be done, and everybody who is interested in it and interested to learn and to share. And we have set up now as Edison the Job to be Done Institute here in Europe with a lot of formats all over the year, all throughout the year. The first one is this webinar here today. We will be in Frankfurt on February 27 for a Job to be Done Sprint, as we call it. So we will run through the whole framework with some examples in a late afternoon, early evening session in Frankfurt. Please have a look at this in our Edison. EdisonInnovation.com site, the big summit conference in March, and then it goes ahead with masterclasses. And masterclass is a format where you will learn throughout the full day in a workshop format how to apply the theory and also apply it to your own challenges. So we will guide you through that for a full day, and the best practice class will be a two-day format that will take place at on-site at a client from us, where you will be on-site and will be looking at the processes there in this corporation. It's a big, very big German corporation that went for a digitalization strategy, and we will share the whole process and the whole project, the job to be done, and ODI project, how it worked out, with you in this best practice class, and that will happen already in June. Now I'm really thank you for. Oh, I see a comment here. Zurich is not in Germany, right? Does it say that Zurich is in Germany? Yes, right. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for that feedback. We will correct that. Thanks a lot. That's it, more or less. I hope you had a nice morning coffee. And let's uncover what your customers really want and make the world